राजेंद्र कुमार
So very good morning to all the participants, our keynote speaker, and all the speakers in the panel. I am privileged to be the host and the moderator for this session. I am Rajendra Kumar. I am additional secretary in the Ministry of Electronics and IT in Government of India. With me, we have a very eminent set of speakers in this panel. The theme of this session is leveraging AI for pandemic preparedness. So as we all know, AI research is playing a key role today in advancing the frontiers of knowledge and technological capabilities in a variety of domains. Medical advancements on the one hand have really helped understanding the spread of an infection and other aspects of the disease. But the advancements in technology that could perhaps aid this entire process in really managing the pandemic better. Powerful tools in the form of AI, machine learning, big data, and other advanced technologies that can help both individually and in combination to enable real-time data collection and analysis and transmission of the knowledge in the entire ecosystem. And this support and this entire enablement through technology can really help the policymakers and the stakeholders to manage the pandemic better, to address the challenges. So this is the theme for the session today. And we are privileged to have as the keynote speaker, Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty. He is the chairman and executive director of Narayana Hospitals. Dr. Shetty, a cardiac surgeon, is the chairman of Narayana Health. He initiated the concept of micro health insurance scheme in Karnataka, which eventually led to the Karnataka government implementing the Yashaswini scheme, a micro health insurance scheme for rural farmers. He is a very well-known personality in the field of both medical education and health sector in India. So without much further ado, I would invite Dr. Shetty for the keynote speech. Over to you, Dr. Shetty.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kumar. Most grateful. If we want healthcare to be affordable, accessible, and safer for the patients, there is only one thing we can do. That is remove the pen and paper from the hands of doctors, nurses, and medical technicians and replace it with a smart digital tool which works on a mobile. Why mobile? Because doctors look at the desktop 5 to 10 times in a day, but they look at their mobile phone 500 times in a day. So if you want them to take care of the data or a notification comes, it has to appear in the mobile phone. We spent more than 15 years in developing these tools. A hospital management system called the Atma, the electronic medical record called Adi, an analytic tool called Medha. So I will be talking mainly about what Medha has done in the context of COVID. It took us we believe that all this transformation, digital transformation of healthcare, would have taken about 10 years for the medical fraternity to accept and patients to accept. But once the COVID started creating trouble in India, in less than 10 days, the medical community and the patient community accepted technology. And you can see today, I see more patients online sitting in my bedroom than I used to see in front of me in the clinic. We believe that in a hospital, only doctors, nurses, and medical technicians should work. All the support staff, we should have a reception without receptionist. We should have a HR department without HR team. All the support staff should be working from home, not covering one hospital, but covering multiple hospitals. And that is a need. Now, why we dream of a hospital today without all the support staff? I'll give you what exactly is happening in the place where I'm sitting now. I'm sitting in Bangalore, our hospital, which is a large hospital with a few thousand beds. We have 400 COVID patients right now in our one building, which can accommodate about 600, 700 patients. There are 100 COVID patients in the ICU and 250 doctors, nurses, medical technicians are infected. It is becoming extremely hard to get doctors, nurses to work in a COVID hospital. They're fed up. It's more than 6 months. So we need to look at how do we give the similar patient care with less number of extremely skilled doctors, nurses, and technicians, because this is not the last epidemic we are going to see. So how do we prepare ourselves using various tools? I'll share my slides. Can I have the first slide? First thing is we do not want our critical care nurses to touch the COVID patients. If they have to touch, it is only for doing a procedure on them, not for knowing what the blood pressure is or the temperature is or what the respiratory rate is or the oxygen saturation is. So we worked with a local team, a startup called Cardiac Design Labs, and they designed a small telemetry device which is attached to the patient. And this is the data we get real time in all the doctor's mobile phone. So our eventual plan is to have a small team of people at the forefront of COVID patients and a large number of senior doctors working from home, planning the strategy of treating, documenting everything. Today, if you look at the COVID patients, there is no medical document because no doctor is able to write anything in that ICU. So all this can be done remotely, and only the doctors who need to intubate, adjust the ventilator, put a central line, only a small group of people should be there. And all the data comes real time, including the ECG, in every doctor's mobile phone. And all these technologies are developed. Of course, we started more than 5-7 years ago, but it made a rapid change, transformation with the COVID. Now, once the data, as I said, when you have 100 patients in the ICU, you cannot tell your doctors and nurses that give equal attention to all the 100 patients, because some are stable, some are unstable. So our Medha analytic team came up with the risk score of risk of developing a cardiac arrest. So you can see various risk score. So anyone with a risk of more than 20% of having a cardiac arrest within the next 24 hours, they are segregated and they are given more attention than the patients with very little risk. And this is the only way you can take care of the vulnerable group of patients when the caseload is massive. One of the biggest problem in a COVID ICU, when you have 100 bed ICU and 150 bed step down unit, you have a lot of patients confined to the bed and there are large number of nurses, doctors taking care. But if you really look at, there are more number of non-doctor, non-technical people going in and out, taking the blood sample, bringing the syringes, disposables, bringing all the implant, whatever they needed to be taken, the required for the bedside care. And do you really need people to do the job? Because we, as I said, we do not want more people to work in this critical environment. Because if they are working, they are vulnerable for their life. And also, if they have COVID, they can also give it to the other doctors and patients, other doctors and the support staff. So we work with another startup in Kerala called Asimo Robotics. And we told them our design about a robot which can shift all the blood samples from point A to point B, or from this material from store to the bedside. It works remotely, and it's a fantastic experience. Now, it's very important that when there are large number of patients, we should know the quality outcome. And also we should look at how much the patient has spent, how much money we spent on each patient. So with the click of a button in a mobile phone tool by Medha, I can see the patient consumption, how many patients are there, what is the average length of stay, what is the average length of ICU, antibiotic utilization, blood consumption, readmission, any data you want, I can have it in my phone. Not only me, any of our doctors in the system. Now, one of the biggest problem is the infection, viral, the bacterial infection happening over the viral infection. So we have a very sophisticated analytic tool developed by team, which gives the emergence of the resistance. We know exactly which area or patient which comes from which part of the country is more vulnerable for a particular infection, because we can track all those data. Very interesting, not now, about 2 years ago, we noticed that the five patients in one particular ICU were specifically getting infected with gram-negative bacteria. An analytic tool kept on alarming that it's happening. Then we checked the wash basin which nurses use for washing was contaminated with the sewage water. So essentially, these analytic tools can give amazing information. This is about where the patients are coming from. Looking at the distribution of patients coming to our hospital, we know where the cluster of COVID can emerge. The other biggest problem we have is managing the inventory for a huge number of patients. Because with the inventory, we know when it expires. At least now we are okay because the supply chain is open. But at the peak of lockdown, supply chain was virtually frozen. And we have a running hospital with a few hundred patients on life-saving support system. So our analytic tool can clearly tell us what the position of the inventory and what is the expiry date. It can even give you when it expires in the next 30 days, 90 days. So we can plan your management of supply chain. This may not be very important for the COVID, but it's important for the hospital. It's about the outstanding dues from the government, from the insurance company, and all the other agencies. If you want to get this data on how much is outstanding from each entity, it will take a minimum 2 to 3 months. But the Medha can give you the data of receivable on a real-time basis. The other interesting thing, again, which may not be appropriate for the COVID, that is the code tracker. Every hospital in the country fixes their package for the procedure, for the treatment, based on what the competitors are charging, not based on the data. And what is the most important data? In healthcare industry, we cannot price the product based on my cost. I should price the product based on what my customer, that is my patient, can afford to pay. Now, how do you know how much patients can afford to pay? So we have an analytic tool called CoTracker by Medha, which gives, if you give the general ward package, the acceptance by the patient is the highest, nearly 85%. And as you keep increasing the package, the acceptance level goes down. So essentially, by keep on tweaking it, you know how much market can afford to pay. Now, everyone talks about technology as a tool for the rich people. I have been treating patients online 17 years ago when Indian Space Research Organization gave us a free satellite. We were treating patients online well before internet started in this world, well before people started talking about the internet connection. I treated 53,000 heart patients in the last 17 years with the ISRO satellite, but it was illegal. We tried hard to convince the medical council to make it legal. It didn't happen. 1 week of COVID, regulation changed. And today, telemedicine is a reality and it is legal. So this is a typical patient who, if anyone thinks telemedicine is for the rich people with a smartphone in their hand, you're mistaken. More than 75% of my patients are like this. This is a patient in Bihar, and she was talking to me on her mobile phone about her mitral valve disease. I was so fascinated, I asked her son to take a photograph of his mother. And this is the photograph. And I looked at the house she's living in. It's a thatch roof house rested on a wall built by somebody else. And this is the lady talking to a specialist doctor in some other part of the country using her mobile phone. And she paid 500 rupees to see me. That's my consultation fees. And when I finished, I thought that 500 rupees doesn't make any difference to me. But for her, it can certainly buy her food requirement for the next 15 days. And that is the day I decided to reduce my consultation fees online to 50 rupees. And this is what people pay today, because this is an amount which I guess may not make much difference. Of course, I was ridiculed in all the social media for a specialist doctor seeing patients for 50 bucks. But this is the reality of our country. So essentially, all the analytics tools we have developed, all the software we developed, all the hospital management system we have developed, this must be available to every hospital on the planet, because 85% of the hospitals in this world do not have a EMR. So we want this to be available. At what price? We want this to be available to every hospital in the world at the price of one disposable plastic syringe per patient per day. Why disposable plastic syringe? Because that is the amount of money which hospital planners, hospital managers do not account when they do the cost of a procedure or their service. And this is the reality. And I believe that India will become the first country in the world to dissociate healthcare from affluence by using the digital technology. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Shetty. That was really a very illuminating talk on the use of technology in healthcare with real examples from your own institution. As you rightly said, analytics can really provide very relevant information to manage both the infections, patients, diseases, hospitals, etc. And remote monitoring of patients probably provides the key to really managing the huge healthcare needs of the country. You also talked about affordable care, which I think is a critical need for a country like ours, where healthcare is not really affordable to the vast majority of the masses. Technology for the poor and the common person can really transform the way the people perceive healthcare in our country. And as you mentioned rightly, telemedicine is now mainstream, probably in part thanks to the pandemic. But I hope this can really become one of the main methods of delivering healthcare in the country. And also your point about reducing consultation fee to just 50 rupees, that's really amazing. So many congrats from our side to this very noble gesture on your part. So thank you so much, Dr. Shetty. Thank you very much for your very illuminating speech. So we will now move on to the panel, which has very eminent speakers to discuss about the role of AI in managing pandemics and addressing challenges of pandemics worldwide. So I'll just briefly introduce the speakers, then we will have individual remarks from each of them. So we have with us on this panel today, Gargi Dashgupta. She is currently director of IBM Research India and the CTO for IBM India South Asia. In her role as director, she is responsible for establishing and executing the technical agenda of IBM's India Research Lab in collaboration with IBM's worldwide research labs and business units. Next, we have Mr. Vikram Dendi. He is the GM and Chief Product Officer for Microsoft's AI plus R New Experiences and Technologies organization. And he acts as the technical advisor to the head of Next NEXT. His recent startup work at Microsoft involved transforming research technologies like machine translation into high value developer and user experiences. Next, we have Dr. Jitendra Sharma. He is the managing director and CEO. He's a healthcare technologist who specializes in the application of technology and innovation in health products and the manufacturing sector. In 2012, he established the healthcare technology division at the National Health Systems Resource Center in the Ministry of Health. We also have Mr. Arvind Sivaramakrishnan. He is the CIO of Apollo Hospitals and is based out of Chennai. He is responsible for the IT strategy and implementation across the Apollo Hospitals group. Arvind has extensive experience in management consulting, architecting, and building solutions for enterprise-wide applications. Next, we have Girish Krishnamurthy. Mr. Krishnamurthy is best known for being a transformational leader, spearheading special initiatives and healthcare innovation at the Tata Group. He holds an MBA from the University of Texas in Dallas and is a graduate in electrical engineering and in mathematics from the University of Madras. We also have Dr. Harpreet Singh. He is a scientist at the Indian Council of Medical Research. He has been the coordinator for ICMR's task force, which established 20 biomedical informatics centers of ICMR in leading medical research institutes and medical colleges with a mandate to nucleate and support informatics in medical research through training programs and services. We also have Dr. Sudeep Gupta. He is a professor of medical oncology at the Tata Memorial Hospital in Mumbai. Dr. Gupta obtained his MBBS degree from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in New Delhi in 1992, and he completed his postgraduate in internal medicine in 1994. We also have Ms. Ashwini Bide. She is currently the additional commissioner in Brihan Mumbai Municipal Corporation. She is known for her work on the Aqua Line, or popularly known as Line 3 of the Mumbai Metro. She has been tasked with overseeing the Mumbai Corporation's contact tracing efforts in this pandemic, as well as to monitor the control room and provide assistance to hospitals. So with a galaxy of eminent speakers in this panel, we hope to have a very useful and relevant discussion on leveraging AI for pandemic preparedness. Just to set the discussion in some context and give the broad contours of the discussion, I would like to mention some of the key aspects about the theme that could be relevant for the speakers to discuss about. When we talk about leveraging AI for pandemic preparedness, a few key points come to mind. Probably the first is AI for diagnostic solutions. these algorithms are focused on reducing the screening time and increasing the testing capacity. These are being leveraged by government agencies and labs worldwide to address this critical challenge during the COVID-19 pandemic. And they would also serve for managing future pandemics as well. The second aspect is leveraging AI for personalized predictions. Machine learning models can be trained to assess an infected person's clinical risk for suffering severe symptoms based on presence of comorbidity, for example, need for intensive care, etc. They can also be used to assess the adequacy of healthcare facilities to handle the cases and take appropriate measures to enhance the capacities accordingly, if required. Based on suitable data, AI can also be used to predict the extent of a spread of the infection in a community. And they can also have several other applications in dealing with pandemics. Perhaps the third major aspect on which we can dwell upon is the use of AI for drug discovery and repositioning. AI can be very useful as a tool in drug discovery and repositioning for of a drug for treatment of COVID-19. It has been used in this context recently in managing this pandemic as well. Several attempts have been made by researchers worldwide in this direction, which are now bearing fruit in really managing the disease in patients. The fourth aspect could be challenges in leveraging AI. This is a critical issue that needs to be addressed and would include getting the right quality and amount of data for training the algorithms and for modeling. Privacy issues, they also come to mind when we talk about using data for testing the algorithms and using it in real life situations, especially because it would involve collecting personal data to some extent and using them for research. Then another major aspect is the issue of enhancing the capacity of the healthcare system to leverage AI for dealing with pandemics. This is a key issue that would need to be addressed when we consider leveraging AI for pandemic preparedness. For example, capacity building of the healthcare professionals and enhancing the responsiveness of the entire ecosystem is critical to this goal, especially in a developing country like India. We can also discuss other topics as the speakers would deem fit in their speeches. I would request all the speakers to please use about 6 to 7 minutes for their initial remarks. And then we will have a discussion among the panelists and we will take questions from the audience. So without much further delay, let me first invite the first panelist, Ms. Gargi B. Dasgupta, for her initial comments.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kumar, and thank you all my co-panelists. Thank you, Dr. Shetty, for this wonderful keynote. And really what I would like to build upon is take all the examples that you gave in how you're using Atma and Medha and really abstract out that what does it mean? What does technology need to solve for this practice to be there in each and every hospital around the world? Yeah, and just not in healthcare institutions. The vision that we are here today for and this whole week is how do we actually transcend to the next wave of getting India to be a digital economy, right? So that means how do we transform with AI our healthcare, our education, our agriculture systems, our supply chains, right? So I'm going to at least give you my perspective of what the vision is and, you know, where we are and what do we need to work on. So the vision, I think, is simple. It's simple and straightforward. I think in 10 years, every organization, we want it to be an AI-led company, right? And so now taking stock of where we are. Where we are is a lot of these good experiments are being done, are being successful. And yet there is some struggle we see in taking that data science experiment, that beautiful analytics that gives you the risk score of a patient into scale and into wide production. And there's been lots of studies as to where are these challenges. And really I'll talk about three. Actually throughout raise, I think many participants have called this out, the data and the complexity of the data and the dependence on AI on data. The complexity of hybrid data is manifold, and yet it is in this hybrid data that lies the power of AI. Why is it so complex, right? Like, let's take the hospital management system. There are many form factors of data. There's the patient data, like you said, the vitals, which we call metrics. There are electronic medical records that show the patient's history. There are diagnostic reports that you've probably printed over the years as to what could be the possible cause and what is the line of treatment. So there's data unlocked everywhere. And maybe there is also emails floating around where you've exchanged with your partner doctors as to what could be a possible line of treatment. So data is complex. It's not trapped in one database. There are many, many systems in which it's fragmented, many users, many personas who create it, who consume it. Sometimes, in fact, even to build a very small nifty AI model, we might have a lot of volume of data, but that data might not have the differentiating features or the features of interest. So this form factor of data spread across multiple systems, you know, with many different users creating it, consuming, creates a lot of challenge. So I would say the complexity of hybrid data and the need to unlock it with technology is very, very key. And I have a slide I'll talk about, you know, how we want to do this, but just outlining the problems. The second one is that this whole thought about having a very, very fundamental framework, or as we call it, an information architecture, right? To consume, to collect the data, to clean the data, to analyze the data till we come to the level of Medha. I think this is a stage that every organization has to go through, and the statistics show that today 80% of the work is actually in the data transformation and cleaning. And we have to switch that, right? I think the goal is to reduce that by half. We have to probably use AI in the data cleaning phase, but we need to do it across, you know, the time series data we have, the structure, the unstructured, the speech, the text. So really what I'm saying is that there is a need for an information architecture, and without the IA, there is no AI. And finally, I think the third wheel that we really need to build on is trustworthiness. Today, when Dr. Shetty comes and talks about Medha, I think it creates inherent trust. Unfortunately, that lineage, that governance, that trustworthiness is not true for AI models, right? So we have to figure out a way how we create a framework in which that trustworthiness can be built, right? And there's many, many factors to it. There is, of course, having the trust that when I change an input to my models, it does reflect in the output. Having the trust that the AI models hold the same levels of accountability as I do or as I expect from my physician in the healthcare system. Being able to explain your results and being able to make sure that all the data sources are secure, I think are all factors that lead to trust. But trust is, you know, a very nuanced topic, but there's a whole stream of research that we can do. But that's the third pillar. So I would say, you know, if we unlock our hybrid data, which is complex, but we use technology to do it, we make sure the AI techniques are scalable and automatable, which is really through an information architecture. And we make sure we have a principled and governed way to build trustworthiness. I think that allows us to get it to the next level. And I think, like everyone said, my last few comments is that it's events like these pandemics that actually push technology adoption at a much, much higher rate and pace. So it's a good thing. I think we should really leverage this. The major technology giants have jumped to it. And let me share one slide, if I can, that talks about. I don't know if you can see my screen, but. Is my screen visible? Yeah. So I think I talked about this. this is our path, right? These are the gears we need to get running so that AI runs like a well-oiled machine. But what have been some of the responses that we've been able to make in this pandemic? Where has technology played a role? So I, of course, have Dr. Singh here. So we worked with ICMR to create conversational AI assistance to actually help the healthcare workers. But overall, I think the idea that you can create AI models to give trusted information and at wide scale to either users, to your citizens, to your healthcare providers, so that the experts can be free to do what they are best, is a great example of how technology can help, right? And it's really beyond chatbots. We've heard about chatbots. It's really being able to have the architecture to process, you know, thousands and thousands of documents, PDFs, human utterances at scale to give the right response. The second one I wanted to say is that there are researchers everywhere, right? Research potential is unlocked in every part of our country. The ability to provide them cycles to actually run exploratory projects, and this is what we did with the High Performance Computing Consortium, where we opened this up to projects. And today, as we speak today, I think we have 87 projects around the world, 6 in India, one of them with IIT Delhi that we are working on, that is actually using this petaflops to run discovery models to understand the proteins in the cells, to run, to really push the barriers of research. But this computing powers available through cloud, it was really, really essential to make this kind of push. And the final one I want to say is that as researchers, so this is a deep search system that we built in a matter of days. And matter of days is important because without the information architecture or without being able to unlock the data, we wouldn't have been able to do this. And really the SOAR system is built on thousands and thousands. It says 46,000 medical journals, but today morning, I think I checked, it's close to a million. A million medical journals, sometimes in PDFs, in Word documents, in scanned PDFs, actually analyzed, understood, represented in form of a knowledge graph so that researchers, scientists, medical practitioners could come and ask questions, could consult it, could search on it. Right, so these are three examples in which we could build AI technologies, but all of them, I would say, have to be built on the three fundamental principles of being able to unlock all sorts of data, having a solid information architecture, and being able to guarantee that you really have this trustworthiness as the domain expert. So I'll stop there, Dr. Kumar.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Dashgupta. That's very relevant comments on the issue of managing data, especially the complex hybrid data for using AI technologies. And also your point about trustworthiness, that's a key to really make the entire AI explainable and also trustworthy for the vast majority of the users who don't really, I mean, understand technology. And there are issues raised often about how secure or how trustworthy the technology itself is. You also mentioned rightly that the pandemic has pushed the adoption technology more than what we could have really hoped otherwise. So next, we will have Mr. Vikram Dendi for his initial remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar, and thank you very much, Dr. Shetty and Gargi Dasgupta. This was really fantastic, and it's been great to see over the last few days the speakers and panelists talk about the opportunity for application of AI to the hardest problems, and also the optimism for what this could mean for a country like India. So I thought maybe today I'll spend a little bit of time on the optimism optimism globally and focus a little bit on what collaboration and partnership would mean in the context of application of AI. A little over 7 months ago, I still pretty vividly recall the afternoon when I got called into an urgent discussion led by our CEO, Satya Nadella. It was the beginning of a massive COVID response effort that mobilized many teams like ours. It was only just starting to become apparent at that time how significant an impact this pandemic was likely to have on our world. Many months later, this work is still continuing and accelerating. In the part of the company where I sit in, which is close to Microsoft Research, it's a meeting ground to understand and tackle the hardest challenges the world faces, where researchers collaborate across many disciplines and advance the state of technology. So these researchers have developed many foundational AI technologies that are transforming the field. An example is ResNet, which has quickly become a fundamental AI building block for image recognition. But our mandate is to use all of that expertise to positively transform healthcare, not on our own, but in partnership with leaders and innovators across the ecosystem, like Dr. Shetty. These partnerships, through ethical and responsible use of AI and the focus on real-world problems, allow us to solve the hardest challenges. So I thought I would share an example to illustrate how this journey from investing in these foundational capabilities to the collective and collaborative response to COVID is showing significant promise, a promise for how we might be able to respond to this and future pandemics. So let me share my screen here. Hopefully you can see that. So our bodies carry within it one of the most finely tuned diagnostic systems, our own immune system. Sometimes a disease gets past your immune system, but most of the time, your immune system keeps the disease in check before you even know you are sick. This adaptive immune system detects disease by using special cells called T cells that have receptors on their surface. These receptors seek out millions of different diseases we encounter and are, for that reason, infinitely diverse. A few years ago, we began a partnership with a company called Adaptive Biotechnologies to help unlock the adaptive immune system. This system is a beautiful machine learning problem, an AI problem, massive but tractable. A single vial of blood has roughly a million T cells, each genetically programmed to target specific antigens. The immunosequencing technology that Adaptive has is able to rapidly give a readout of these million strings. What is important is that this may have all the information that we need in principle to understand what infectious diseases, what cancers, and what other immune disorders your immune system is contending with right now. The problem that AI comes in to solve here is to extract that information by translating the language of the T cell DNA receptors into the language of disease-related antigens. And then further, apply AI again to sort the derived antigens and do something in computer science called topic identification to understand what disease your body is dealing with. There is a scale to it that is a little bit daunting, but on the same scale as problems that we have actually already solved using many of the AI foundations that we already built, like machine translation and web search. Ultimately, the dream of this, as we started down this path, was a moonshot to develop a blood test for early and accurate detection of many diseases. Think of it as a universal diagnostic. Now, when the pandemic started, COVID-19 became a significant focus for our combined teams. In fact, as we all are seeing with COVID, every person presents this disease to their immune system in a slightly different way and often with a different outcome. Dr. Shetty was talking about that earlier. And this is precisely the challenge that the combination of Microsoft's AI and adaptive immunomics platform were already tackling for other diseases. So over the past several months, the teams have been hard at work collecting thousands of blood samples to map the T cell response to the COVID virus to understand how T cells do their job. The team is curating this data in a database and making it publicly available to researchers all around the world. When the teams first began looking at this novel coronavirus, we weren't entirely sure what to expect. But what we and others are learning is that the role of the T cell is actually very important. We can talk a little more about this in the panel discussion if time permits. But largely what we are learning is that being able to study T cells and being able to test for T cells could be a very important complement to testing serology, especially in less severe cases where antibodies may not be present. So this testing adds a critical dimension to how we might measure immunity of an individual or a population, which is in turn important for containing the pandemic, or alternatively for understanding how and when we go back to work, school, and life. So this effort that started before COVID is now resulting in progress towards developing a test that uses T cells as a marker to indicate past infection. Our teams are working hard to bring it into practice soon. What is clear today, especially for those who are at the intersection of technology, health and life sciences, is that two things are true. One, there has never been a more consequential time to be in these fields as we work together to fight a once in a century pandemic. This has created an urgency that has accelerated progress in healthcare tremendously. Two, the need for nonlinear transformation is urgent, because the present is unsustainable. As Dr. Dasgupta was saying, the data challenges and fragmentation is just one of the many challenges that we have to overcome. And this is only possible through deep collaboration between every person and organization reflected in the agenda throughout this event. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Dendi. That was, I think, a very relevant intervention on the aspect of ethics and responsible use of AI, and also the use of the technologies, the urgency that it has really brought before us to deploy them for dealing with pandemics like this immediately. Also, deep collaboration among different stakeholders to really accelerate the use of AI. That's a very critical point that we all need to focus upon. So moving on, next I would like to invite Dr. Jitender Sharma for his remarks. Dr. Sharma?
Yes. Good morning, everyone. And good morning to Dr. Shetty also. Thank you for that beautiful note. Am I audible? Yeah. So I have 3 points to make as my opening thoughts. You see, by an accident, one of the reports that came to review came for review to me today was European Medical Technology Industry. I was just fishing out some data from it for an urgent a policy note that we have to develop. What was surprising is that in the European market in 2019, when you hit top 10 technical fields where patent applications were made, pharmaceuticals was at 7,697, which is sixth from the bottom. The top is digital communication, which is 14,175. And medical technology is number two, which is 13,833. Just imagine what this tells. It tells that the world of application and the world of resources is shifting from traditional pharmaceutical interventions to digital communication and medical technology. That's live data that has come this morning. And pharmaceutical applications are half of what is medical technology, and digital communication is 10% more than that of medical technology patents, which means the global resource pool have already understood where the buck is, where the business is, where the solution is, and where the market is. And all I'm trying to say is the sooner we realize, the less would be the loss. Actually, there is no gain. We are already late. Now, in the application of AI, there are three verticals in which we tend to basket our health services. Now, Dr. Devi Shetty, a temple that he heads, and he has built Narayan Hridayalaya. Some of us have been very lucky to be visitors there multiple times. Has one advantage. And that advantage is that it harmonized its processes in the institution quite early. And then after harmonizing those processes, used tools to bring in efficiency and accuracy. Now, the problem with the rest of the institutions in healthcare is that we are not organized, even within the institution, because the leaders in healthcare and the founders tend to take tend to run these organizations as it appears convenient and appropriate to them, and not what leads to a process which can actually make them redundant after some time. Now, and that is a fact. Now, one of the verticals when we think of AI in healthcare is, do our hospitals have electronic health record interface? Answer would be yes, many of us have. But then the next question is, do all hospitals' electronic health records are interfaceable with each other? And the answer is no. Which means when a patient from Bihar can actually speak to Dr. Shetty, at a cost less than $1 per consultation and get best of the care, for some reason, if this lady has to go to AIIMS Patna, AIIMS Patna does not have the advantage of what Dr. Shetty diagnosed. And therefore, our real problem is not using the tool ourselves, but allowing others to know what we used and found out. Now, this leads us to the problem of lack of standards of interoperability within the electronic health record systems. That's one. Two, it cuts off straight away those hospitals which does not have resources to adopt any electronic health record system. So those who have resources, they have isolated record systems, and those who don't have are out of our universal set. Now, problem number two, the vertical number two, is application of AI in machines. So you see behind me, it's a beautiful medical technology zone, the first medical technology zone globally, where right from robotic surgery systems, second in the world, to world's fourth MRI, world's fifth CT scan, ventilators, COVID diagnostic kits, almost 5 lakh tests a day are all getting manufactured in the hundreds of factories that you see behind me. Now, these machines use AI tools to augment their function of delivery. And in those tools, the clinical input does not get added concurrently. Which means when we design a robotic surgery system, something equivalent to Da Vinci, something that we have RoboSurge, it's based on the data that we accumulated over thousands of experiments and biomedical intervention simulations, built a system, but this system, despite being intelligent, is not intelligent enough to learn forward as we prospectively. The entire interventional knowledge in the machine from a cath to an MRI which signifies the intelligence in a medical technology machinery is based on retrospective knowledge. there is no way to factor in the prospective knowledge in these machines. And our users, doctors, surgeons, do not have tools to allow them to use concurrently being generated knowledge to improvise the machine. That's vertical two. Vertical three is, from all the interventions that we use, it all adds to information. From this information, do we get knowledge? No. Unless the systems institutionally are designed to be smart enough, and even national and state level insurance and assurance systems are designed to be smart enough, we do not have knowledge coming out of information. Now, the reason I am saying this is when we created the National Diagnostics Program of India in 2016 and launched it nationally, it's being now operated in 18 states in India under public-private partnership mode. What we didn't realize is we would be generating millions and millions of data fields that are coming out of our blood tests being operated in private labs for which the government is paying for the cost of testing. That was National Diagnostics Program in public-private partnership mode. We designed it from the Health Ministry, Government of India. We were surprised to see that in 57 provinces, sub-provinces, we call it mandals in a particular state, over 3 years, there was a rising trend, and this state has over 750 mandals, which are sub-provinces under the districts. In 57 out of 742 sub-provinces, mandals, the triglycerides were consistently rising. And we have someone like Dr. Shetty to tell us what it means. We all know rising triglycerides is actually looking at a non-communicable disease epidemic. And what we did is we spoke to and it's all mined data. The data that was mined as the data was coming out. We spoke to the state government, and in those 57 sub-provinces, we substituted in the fair price food ration shops, we substituted the white rice with brown rice and white rice with millets. And guess what is the difference? The triglycerides are now declining because you have actually used the healthcare data, not used in health department, but used it in food supplies department, and have modulated the lifestyle of certain number of habitations towards a healthier life. So all I'm trying to say is that when we look at AI, the three verticals in which a medical technology and health system looks at it is one, are our AI tools talking to each other? Is there interoperability? Can the knowledge generated for Narayan Hridayalaya can be used by AIIMS Patna and generated by Savita Nursing Home can be used by Nilofer Hospitals? From Daman and Diu to Murshidabad, it doesn't make a difference. To do that, we need to have more and more hospitals adopting electronic health record. But the problem is it costs. And the smaller hospitals don't have the deep pockets or even a fair price to invest on that cost. So what we have just done is that we have created a Digital Health Alliance India, in which we are bringing in thousands and hundreds of EMR providers on a platform like Paytm. So it will be the UPI of payment gateways, UPI of electronic health records. So like Paytm, you have a Digital Health Alliance India in which hundreds of electronic health record providers are registered. And they are registered if they fulfill two conditions. All of them will have to give a certain number of electronic health record modules as free downloadable package. It doesn't cost. And that minimal package is sufficiently minimal not to cost them a lot of money, but large enough for hospitals to embark on a digital health record journey because it doesn't cost them. It's free. However, what is free is really small and limited. And for the additional services like storage, analytics, and so on, the hospitals can pay the electronic health record provider, anyone that they choose on the UPI. But the payment has to be on cost per bed per month basis, like an electricity bill, not in hundreds of crores of buying computers and servers. So what we have done is, one, we have created a free package for the hospitals that do not want to invest on resources. And two, we have annuitized their cost of electronic health record on cost per bed per month. That's one. On the vertical two, machine learning prospective generated data on the care, its ability to be fed into the machines and help the doctors improve on the machine is something that we are working on with wonderful partners, leading to something as fantastic as non-invasive hemoglobin meter, something very small. But we all know that in olden days, doctors would check our eyes to see whether we are anemic or not. Today, we take a blood sample, but that blood sample can actually give cross-infection if the same syringe or needle is used and so on, and it costs money. So we have now tools that can actually look in our eyes and can give digital hemoglobin, and with every additional reading makes the machine better and better. And number three, using generated data, particularly from pathology labs, under the guidance of beautiful agencies that Ministry of Electronic has, can actually inform not the health department, but multiple departments like road transport, like food supplies, to modulate the lifestyle of individuals, helping them achieve a healthier lifestyle. So I have just shared with you three verticals where problem exists and three humble steps that we have taken to find solution to these problems. And I look forward to engaging more with more remarks from our esteemed colleagues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma, for making some very relevant points. I think your point about ensuring that we follow standards and ensure data interoperable, that's really a very relevant point in today's context. I think you may be aware that Government of India has now launched the National Digital Health Mission, for which one of the key goals is to ensure that all the hospitals, they have EHR and they are interoperable. So I hope in the time to come, we can address this critical issue of delivering better healthcare to our people using technology. So moving on, in the interest of time, we next have Mr. Arvind Sivaramakrishnan. I would request all these speakers to kindly limit their remarks to 7 minutes because we are running slightly behind schedule. Mr. Sivaramakrishnan.
Namaste, everybody. Good morning to all of you. Now we're talking about AI in a pandemic situation. I'm probably not sure if I will be crossing my limits if I say that healthcare has always been in a pandemic situation. We are a planet of a billion people. We are not having the means to service the healthcare needs of a billion people. And we have continuously a non-communicable disease problem, call it pandemic problem, issue, whatever is the right adjective that we can give to it, that's been talking of numbers that are beyond our ability to manage. And this is clearly a problem that obviously affects the economics of a society, of a nation. So just that COVID has presented itself in a manner that has given all of us a rather rude wake up. So if I were to look at it in terms of, you know, how Sir Winston Churchill said, never let go a good crisis to waste, that's probably what we should look at, because at least the appreciation of how technology can be constructive in bringing together the delivery of healthcare in a traditional manner that is perceived as always to be done with physical contact has been proven that it can be done. And here, I think the one aspect that we need to look at in terms of how we can bring in artificial, when we say artificial intelligence, I think we need to start looking at every sort of a guided algorithm that brings in a perspective of predictive and prescriptive logic. That's well-termed in, and when I say well-termed, obviously using good evidence-based practice. That way we can look at building capacity. And again, the COVID problem has brought to light the need for capacity and the need to act fast and the need to act at levels of perfection that just cannot be compromised. So when Dr. Sharma was talking about, can what is being done in Bangalore be available in Patna? That is the problem that technology is fundamentally looking at in terms of that democratization with capacity building, giving that level of surety so that healthcare when practiced really helps the clinical providers in the forefront do the best of the best and not worried about everything that is around them. So how do we make our algorithms, AI, ML, cognitive algorithms, any amount of big data analytics that gives us learning, whether it is infection control surveillance or whether it is looking at AI around cardiovascular diseases. You're looking at all of that so that one, we catch the population at the right time and not allow it to go late. And that itself will serve healthcare and the entire population. And now when we do this, the obvious issue of how do we get the right resources and the talent to do all of this, I think that is an aspect that all of us need to severely invest on in ensuring that we have this as a sustainable and not a one-time activity. What do we mean by sustainable and one-time activity? That means that we build this across enterprises, we build this across practices, and we build this such that it is sustainable. I think this is not about a proof of concept or a pilot project that obviously in a constrained setting gives spectacular results. This is about ensuring that it works for all the 360 degrees of direction that we can think of and all the complexities that it can present. And when we say that there's no surety on any complexity that anything is going to provide, how do we look at maximizing this power? Not coverage of everything in terms of length and breadth, but maximizing that. So we need to look at that capacity of resourcing that will sustain this. And now when all of this happens, automatically the costs start becoming right-sized. Improper for me to say free or not free. Yes, free is an expectation. Let's not shy away from that expectation because the socioeconomic parity is significantly different. So free is an expectation. How do we right-sized cost so that the technology industry is not going to be stretched? At the same time, the healthcare industry is not going to be left longing for it. I think we need to look at this, and the AI aspect of it really brings this problem to some set of dimension that can force results. And this together also not only to look at this from the clinical and the electronic medical record aspect of healthcare, but please look at it from a transactional aspect so that the transaction and the work process that is going to enable this AI is done in a very friendly manner that is useful for the provider, the clinical community that looks at it, doctors, nurses, the medical technicians. Another very, very powerful aspect of any algorithm, machine-based, machine learning-based algorithm, cognitive algorithm, is to look at the operational and the supply chain aspect of healthcare that is powering the clinical teams to do what they can do best and to take for granted what the support system of the enterprise can do. Take for granted, because that automatically helps the clinical people do the best of the best and make sure their outcomes are never compromised. And that means the operational, the supply chain, the financial ecosystem that supports it is powered by powerful technology, guided by data of their own learning, so that all patterns are well handled. By patterns well handled, time is saved. If time is saved, there is going to be speed to diagnosis. The speed to diagnosis, we have capacity building. Otherwise, there is no magical way by which physical capacity is going to come at any place on the face of earth. We are going to be struggling to make ends meet. So this is how I would say we can put AI and ML using the current pandemic as our, jump starter a rude awakening that is given to all of us in terms of our readiness, acceptance, mindset, change management, and the change in culture that we are all doing. Thank you, Dr. Rajendra. Over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Shivaramakrishnan. I think you made some very relevant points, especially on the aspect of making use of technology sustainable on a long-term basis. It's not just the pandemic-driven, need for all of us, but we need to also ensure that we can use this new technology for on a longer-term basis in our healthcare system. Also, your aspect about focus on outcomes, that's a critical point. We need to ensure that the technology use is not for using tech per se, but is focused on delivering the desirable outcomes in the entire healthcare delivery system. So moving on, next we have Dr. Harpreet Singh. I would request him to please keep to the time limit of 7 minutes.
Absolutely, sir. I'll stick to the time. Okay. So I am, as sir said, I am working as scientist at the Indian Council of Medical Research, and I'm also heading the Division of Biomedical Informatics. So my division is looking at data management of various programs of ICMR, including this COVID-19 testing data. So we have developed this system in-house and implemented. This system is collecting data about patient demography, patient categories, which include healthcare workers, sari, pregnancy, and lot of minor details about patient tests, CT values, sample collection. So a lot of this data can be used for TAT analysis, for managing the supply chain, and for looking at the mortality rates, and then predicting the comorbidity factors, or making the risk scores, which Dr. Shetty was talking about. So I'll now come to two places where we have used not the AI, but simple analytics to optimize the system. So we have used simple analytics in optimizing the testing capacity. So where we have used testing, then positivity rates, and then the sample movement. So these three data points we have used and tried to optimize, and you can see the results that initially from 1 crore to 2 crore tests, we took approximately 29 days, but with the recent one from 7 to 8 crores, we took only 9 days. So this is the capacity optimization that we have done using simple analytic tools. So since we were very busy in managing the COVID data, which is coming at a very fast pace, so we have recently started using AI for predicting some mortality ratios and all. And our preliminary data suggests that we have developed a couple of models which shows that mortality can be predicted with an AUC of 0.8 using various models. Simple logistic regression gives 0.84, and then other models give AUC of approximately 0.9 to 0.92. And the significant parameters which have came from these models are, some of the parameters are specific to the geographical location. So which is very interesting to see, you know, how geographical locations are affecting the mortality. But these are preliminary models that we have developed. Other parameters which came significant were patient categories, which of course is understandable, age, and then the various comorbid conditions which are associated. So different comorbid conditions have different impact on the mortality rates. So these are some of the areas where in the COVID itself we have started using, and there's AI models. And using AI models, you know, further, we can use these AI models to further enhance and optimize the testing capacities and enhance and predict the morbidity, mortality, spread, and other areas. The major challenge which I can see using, working in the COVID and other systems, I'll show you a couple of slides. Just quickly run through these slides. So the major challenge which I see is, I completely agree with Gandhiji and Dr. Sharma, we should make the hybrid data systems accessible, because all the different data systems are working in silos. And what Dr. Sharma talked about were the interoperable standards, which is absolutely required. So since COVID is not just one pandemic, there are a lot of other pandemics which are going on, like antimicrobial resistance is one pandemic which is going unheard. Then there is second pandemic of mental health disorders, which is going unheard in various parts of India. So if we want to tackle those pandemics, the heard one and the unheard pandemics, we have to start thinking of developing some sort of infrastructure, some sort of framework, which I'll show you in one slide, which can help in interoperability between different data sources. So now just two slides I'll quickly run through from the ICMR point of view, what ICMR is doing. Is this slide visible, sir? Yeah. So ICMR per se is the one of the premier medical funding research agency. It generates lots and lots of data. So at a given moment, we have some 1200 to 1400 projects running all across medical colleges, different medical colleges and medical research institutes. So this data, which is generated, if it is given, made available to the public, to the researchers, it can do wonders. So keeping that in mind, ICMR published this document somewhere in 2017. It's ICMR Strategic Plan and Agenda Document 2030. So this shows how serious we are in terms of developing data standards, rationalizing systems, and developing integrated platform. Now, going in line with that document, we started a three-phase program in ICMR for establishing ICMR research data platform. So first phase of this program is over, where we have nominated, we have developed SOPs, nominated data coordinators in each of the ICMR institute. First round of cataloging of different data sources, just before the hybrid, has already been done. We have found out which thematic area, how many data sources we have. For retrospective data, we have developed data management plans and other things. And then in second and third phase, we'll try to develop integrated research platform. So sir, I'll rush too fast. These are a few challenges that we faced. One of the major challenge was the diversity in different data systems, the formats, the vocabulary they are using. So to overcome that, we are proposing to develop SOPs and uniform standards in data collection, which will improve the data quality. Access of these data systems is another challenge. Most of the time, the data is available on the desktops and in the institutional servers. So this I'm talking from the research data perspective, not the healthcare system and all. Integration is another very big challenge, then policy and the research platform. These are some of the data systems that my team is working, which runs across communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, maternal and child health, and various other areas. So these are the systems that my team has developed. So this is the architecture or the framework that we are working on. This framework we are trying to implement. In fact, we have developed the first version of the software, which will be rolling out for antimicrobial resistance. So what this software is, say different sites are different locations where the data is being collected. So in the client server model, all data has to travel to the server. And then the server gives the various analytics. But here we have developed an API enabled software, which will put in all the different sites. That software transmits not the raw data, but the summary data for related, if at a centralized place, one person puts a query that what is the resistance of amikacin across India. So this centralized server push that query to all the sites, and then all the sites give the summarized figures back to the server. So these summarized figures are then put. So this will, you know, rule out the possibility of having different standards, because we'll be mapping all the sites at the centralized location. We'll rule out the possibility of having very big infrastructure placed at the centralized location, because all the sites can have their own small infrastructure and can start providing the data. So this is from, you know, I'll end up with saying that interoperability is one of the major challenge that we are facing. And probably if we'll overcome this challenge, we'll definitely have better AI models and better AI systems. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Harpreet Singh. I think that was a very nice exposition on the role of ICMR. And I have seen this happening in front of my own eyes, because the testing capacity has really gone up, and that has been possible through the use of technology. And also your point about diversity data systems and ensuring interoperability, that also is a key to really sustaining the use of technology in healthcare delivery systems. So moving on, next we have Mr. Girish Krishnamurthy from Tata Medical Diagnosis. Over to you, Mr. Krishnamurthy.
Thank you, Dr. Rajendra Kumar. And in the interest of time, even though in the beginning of the session you set up 7 boundary points on which we can discuss, I would classify both into 2 big buckets. One is on the diagnosis side and another is on healthcare delivery. And I'll just first address it, some of our thoughts and principles, what I feel needs to be there in the healthcare delivery model, so that the effective utilization of AI and machine learning all come into front. So some of the principles, what I feel, see, in the last 25, 30 years of innovation in healthcare, if you look at it, it is predominantly makes an assumption that when a patient is with a doctor or in a medical system, that's where either in a procedure room or in an operation theater or in a clinic or in an OPD, most of the innovation was going on that side. The real problem of the world in healthcare is on the delivery, which is how do you get a patient to a doctor in a right time and a right place in a right way. Now, taking that further into a data, when technology providers, when they started looking at the data in other industries, be it manufacturing, retail, banking, financial services, we all seen in last 30 years or 40 years, by consolidating the data in a central place, in a standard interoperable manner, we saw a big efficiency improvement. Whereas the last 20, 25 years, healthcare is attempting to do globally, we see very limited impact. The reason, if you go a little deeper, healthcare data is very different from compared to any other data. 5 minutes before your BP is no longer valid. That means the intelligence behind data is very, very critical. The third part, which is also plays a very important role, which Dr. Shetty brought it up. When a patient is there, when a doctor is there and an infrastructure is in place, what is the necessity of a technology there? It is not intuitive neither for the patient nor for the doctor. That means healthcare is requires some kind of an omniscient kind of a technology, which is what Dr. Shetty alluded into a mobile phone based technology, but it is not what he really means as a health practitioner, that you develop as a technologist, as an omniscient kind of a technology. So given this background in Tata Group, we have been experimenting several of this in the last 3-4 years. To our credit, close to about 4.5 million Indian citizens are currently in our management. We have done a deeper work to see this in a close corner in cancer. Close to more than 1 million patients we manage in a daily basis in cancer. And we manage about 3.5 million Indian citizens in a primary and secondary healthcare system along with the public health system. With this experience, we entered into this pandemic. The day one when the pandemic, I vividly remember the first week of February, that we had a very clear-cut thinking that testing is going to be a challenge in pandemic. And so we put several effort in developing AI-based, technology-based testing experiments. And Dr. Rajendra Kumar, you're also part of one of the sessions what we had on this whole thing. We came up with the concept called minimum testing and maximum intelligence. What technology and AI and data did in pandemic scenario, we took one Indian district. We just took only 1,000 tests we did on a sentinels. And we were able to clearly predict 4 to 5 months of graph of that particular district. When we are actually doing this research, it is hardly a totally a green district, no COVID cases. And so that actually brought a lot of people in India together to make this happen. It's not just Tata did it. So the deeper participation from ICMR, deeper participation from the health department, most importantly, a deeper participation with the scientific community. This pandemic experiment gave us also a parallelly a confidence, which you have seen currently, that we are able to develop a genomics-based test, first in the world, for commercially be available. To look at the deeper the test, if you look at it, this test is a purely AI-based test. The first diagnosis test coming with a pure 100% image processing for results detection. And this is a product which is developed in India indigenously along with the partnership with the Indian laboratories. The competition or the comparable organizations are the mighty MITs and Berkeleys. They have been in this space for the last 9 years in doing deeper research. As an Indian, there cannot be a proud moment. Within 100 days, we are able to produce this technology. The technology, which is very, very different compared to those scientists, what they are looking at it, because they were looking at a genomics, gene editing, CRISPR model in cutting the gene. And we were working on binding the gene, which is very different. Nobody looked at this gene sensing in binding model. Now, this experiment in the diagnosis space, it opens up a very big foray on the coming years for the not only the future pandemics and epidemics, more importantly, in the area of pathogens and cancer detection. Now, this is fundamentally driven by an AI-driven algorithm. And it is here and now opportunity. Now, if you also look at pandemic diagnosis a little deeper, the testing is not going to stop. The vaccine comes in, more tests has to be done. Vaccine, if you need to administer vaccine, before vaccine, you need to administer test. And regular administration of this test. So we are walking into a space where in a molecular biology space has never all along been in Indian scientific world has been ignored, has come into foray, and which is coming to totally redefine the way the healthcare is going to be delivered. Now I quickly move on the healthcare delivery piece, especially in the data piece. See, one of the principles we follow in healthcare data, and some of the panelists has been experienced with me together in this last year, 10 years of journey. Healthcare data, wherever it is, however it is, whatever it is, we need to have the ability to process it. And some of the principles today in the Prime Minister's announcement of Digital India Health Digital Mission, which is encompasses this thought process. And we have developed a technology which we specifically named called Concentric Data Repository, which eliminates a lot of complexity the world went through. Some of my co-panelists from IBM and Microsoft, they were also involved in some of this discussion with us. This particular technique totally eliminate the traditional health information exchange of interoperability requirement. We have tested this out in cancer care. Cancer care has got the maximum variability in terms of the data, especially in healthcare. Next comes to cardiac, next comes to gastro. So we are able to bring the data with the principle, however, whatever, wherever, it is a delight. We have the ability to use it. That is the way we can progress. If you wait for the interoperable standard to happen, standards will come, but following the standards has been the challenge. It's not only in India. You have seen Australia as an example is only a 24 million population country. Still, they are not able to standardize it. So we cannot kid ourselves saying that with 1.3 billion population, I will have an interoperable system standardized, and ICMR and MHA and individual state health systems, as well as all the private players, both on the corporate side and the nursing home side and the local rural clinics and pharmacies and diagnostic center overnight are going to come into a standard and become interoperable. We need to understand our reality, and AI comes to rescue that. And I will stop it here, Dr. Rajendra Kumar. I have a lot of things, but given the interest of the time, we can enter into a discussion forum later on.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Krishnamurthy. I think you made some very relevant points, especially with regard to the focus that you laid on the delivery of healthcare systems, and also on minimum testing and maximum intelligence. I think that's a very useful phrase when we talk about use of technology in healthcare delivery systems. So in the interest of time, moving on to the next panelist, I would like to invite Ms. Ashwini Bide from the Mumbai Municipal Corporation to give her initial remarks.
Good morning. Thank you, Rajendra sir, and thank you, other panelists. This has been quite an insightful session, where multiple possibilities were explored to leverage AI for pandemic and overall health sector management. I just want to make a very small but solid point that a public sector body like Mumbai Municipal Corporation actually applied and utilized AI tools and data-driven insights to manage the pandemic in Mumbai in a reasonably well manner, while Mumbai was one of the worst hit cities of this pandemic. Can you see my screen? So this is possible because of the involvement of various stakeholders and professionals in the sector of AI and data management. I just want to demonstrate this to my all know that is the economic capital of India and the biggest gateway to India in every vibrant city. But that is what makes the pandemic situation very challenging in Mumbai. And it is further challenging because of the population density of the city and the demographic composition. We know that Mumbai is one of the most densely populated cities in the world. And on top of it, 60% of its population live in slums. That is why when the slum like Dharavi, where more than 200,000 people live in 1 square kilometer area, it really becomes difficult to live with the pandemic with the regular lockdown measures, as well as this tracing, tracking, or quarantining strategy. And that is why the adopted strategy, which was very popular at that point of time, couldn't resonate with the ground realities in Mumbai. And that is why the initial phase of pandemic was quite overwhelming. There was a lot of fear and uncertainty, and because of the extreme lockdown also, there were a lot of constraints on the resources. We had huge resources to deal with the challenges, but we were having very scant resources. And that's why we tried, but we couldn't stop the viral spread. In April, our daily cases were roughly 400, which in May, they jumped to 1200. We were criticized also a lot for not being able to manage. We were given examples of other states and cities, which at that point of time appeared to be managing the pandemic much better. But we were a bit overwhelmed, confused. Media was painting a grim picture. And the overall time was full of fear, uncertainty, mistrust, and rumors also among this thing. And the future looked a bit hazy because we were not able to basically fathom how much is the scale and spread of this pandemic, how much to be prepared for, and how much health infrastructure is considered to be to this pandemic. And then we took a pause and pondered. We had a lot of information. There was information overload, but no actionable insight. And that is why we pondered. We realized that there is no point in just attempting to stop the virus, because it was bound to be there by the sheer virtue of population density and socioeconomic complexity of the city. It was not possible to put the genie back in the bottle, but it was possible to manage its movements by observing the trends through deep dive analysis and projections. And that is where we decided to use our data in a proper way, convert it into data-driven insights, and use it for our decisions and actions. So this is how we adopted the strategy of capturing the data, learning the quantitative understanding, observing emerging trends, and then taking right strategic and tactical decisions, convert them into right actions to set up proper protocols, proper processes. And just to give an example, in the initial phase, we realized that we created huge number of institutional quarantine and isolation centers for positive patients in slums. But before the government of India came with the concept of COVID care centers, and that helped us dealing with the pandemic in slum population, and we could substantially reduce it. Dharavi's success story was part of it. Similarly, our early deep dive death analysis indicated that CFR is more due to unavailability of beds for suspected patients who were severely symptomatic but the test results were awaited. So we created huge bed capacity in our COVID facilities for such patients. And on top of it, AI-based checks, chest x-rays helped us decide treatment protocol for such patients even before the COVID test results were known. So at the center, there were thousands of frontline execution teams. We were decision makers and supervisors, but all their efforts could become meaningful and more relevant because of the various verticals surrounding them, like the AI solutions, the tech platforms and solutions, deep dive insights and projection, also the social media and website updates. These are the several entities who partnered with BMC to provide the expertise on pro bono basis. And you can see the timeline also from early March, many well-known entities also partnered with us and many new startup companies also approached us. And Mumbai Municipal Corporation was, you know, open enough to accept all these people, go with some experienced partners, but at the same time, allow some experiments also to take place. So we had these various verticals, all AI-driven deep dive analysis and projections were provided to us by teams like Fractal, L&T Variant, Vadhvani AI, TIFR. Then there were some AI-based screenings because we, apart from the diagnostics, we used this AI for the patient screenings also. So Cure AI helped us, Radical helped us with a screening for comorbidities through retinal scans. Then there were information management dashboards which were prepared, and companies like McKinsey, EY, PwC, they partnered with us. We had location-based insights through agencies like Google GIS, Esri, Genesis, and now Google has partnered with us, and all our containment zones are on Google Maps actually. The key tech solutions were provided by AWS, PharmEasy, Mahakavach and Arogya Setu, as well as Uber. And of course, the information and communication platforms like Google, even WhatsApp, Twitter and Zoom. We have started using Zoom late February itself. And all these things helped us in setting up as a proper system to basically deal with this pandemic. We realized that we can't stop it, but we can manage it properly. And just to go into slightly in detail of what exactly these AI solutions did. So Fractal, L&T Variant and Madhvani AI, they basically helped us in social text and location analytics, which we used in very effective manner. There were video analytics because initially when there were lockdowns and we had many containment zones with very within thickly populated, are 200 to 300 CCTV cameras which were monitoring these containment zones. These video analytics were introduced. The local police stations as well as our ward officers started getting messages through that, and they could manage it even with a limited manpower. We had a predictive analysis provided by Fractal and AI, which helped us actually giving a lot of insights even at the municipal ward level, because we have 24 wards, 227 electoral wards within that. So these predictive analysis give us a huge insight into what is happening at each ward level, because some of our wards are having predominantly some populations, some wards have elite societies. So how to deal with all these different kinds of population, we could get those insights through these predictive analytics. We also got to know how many cases are going to be there in, say, next 2 weeks, 3 weeks, what kind of resources are required, and we could equip ourselves with adequate bed capacity or adequate oxygen capacity, as well as other medical equipment. This is huge jumbo capacities, which were more than 1,000, and where it was much better as a in the morning, where we used high-resolution CCTV cameras, contactless kind of an arrangement between the doctor and the patients. We manage these facilities with limited number of doctors and health workers, and also used a very sophisticated patient management systems. So plus there were a lot of deep dive analysis for testing, for infection insights, for mortality insights, as well as the containment zone insights. So wherever it was possible to use the data in an effective manner, and wherever we these data driven possible, there were AI-based things. Very early stage of the pandemic, only Cure AI help us with this AI instead X-ray chest based screenings, where the testing capacity was very limited at that point of time. So this helps us in prioritizing the testing also. And I already told you where the suspect cases used to come, where the test results were awaited based on this AI assisted chest X-ray screenings, we could treat the patients and save many lives. Then came radical with retina scan-based screenings.
Yeah, Ashwini, if I can just intervene, if you can kindly conclude in next 2 to 3 minutes, because I want
Yes. So these are the details. So this is my last slide where I just want to say that because of these data-driven insights and AI tools, we had a better grip on the evolving situation. Today also our cases have not abated. 2,000 plus daily cases we are getting. However, our entire system of pandemic management protocols and a professional manpower is fully in place, and we could achieve that with the help of AI tools as well as data-driven insights. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Ashwini Bide, for such a illuminating analysis of what Mumbai did to manage the pandemic using data-driven technologies, especially use of AI for managing the huge caseload. That really is a good example of how we can mainstream use of technology in managing pandemics. Next, we have Dr. Sudeep Gupta from TMC.
So good afternoon, everyone. Before I begin, I would like to thank Dr. Rajendra Kumar for inviting me to this important session, which couldn't be more opportune given the current situation, and I enjoyed listening to the previous speakers. So as you mentioned, I bring you greetings from Tata Memorial Center, which is the largest cancer center in India with a long pedigree of service, education and research. And I must add that we are an autonomous unit under the Department of Atomic Energy, the Government of India. So I must say that our core expertise is in managing patients with cancer, but we do have some experience in using machine learning algorithms in general and convolutional neural networks in particular with medical images as they relate to cancer. But I am a medical oncologist and I'm an expert in chemotherapy for cancer. So I must say that I'm not an expert on AI, although I do take some interest in its applications. So I was very interested in the theme of your discussion, which was leveraging AI for preparedness for pandemics. And that term preparedness essentially implies the future, because you have to be prepared today for what will happen in the future. So I suppose our discussions are about what we can do now in order to be prepared for the future. So in this context, I just want to say that the system as well as the ecosystem should be tuned and ready for applications such as AI, because such preparedness doesn't happen in an instant. And for future pandemic preparedness, we must emphasize collection, flow, integration, and synthesis of high quality but minimum data sets that will lend themselves to both AI and non-AI applications. And I would like to emphasize the phrase minimum, because an overly ambitious data collection plan has a high likelihood that it will never be implemented. We have had past opportunities in many zoonotic and vector-borne diseases, and all of us know that Japanese encephalitis, for example, strikes many parts of India regularly. And unfortunately, I must say that we have not adequately utilized these opportunities and have been more or less in the reactive mode. So what I'm essentially saying is that pandemic preparedness arises out of previous preparedness for epidemics and outbreaks, of which we have had plenty. So I will not be repetitive about what other speakers have said, but I will briefly make only 4 points and I will finish in the next 5 minutes, because I'm cognizant that you are running out of time. The first point is about herd immunity. And all of us, I think, understand that unless an effective vaccine becomes available soon, as in and is implemented on a mass scale, the course of this pandemic is likely to be determined by the development of some kind of herd immunity. And we have also heard that based on its transmissibility, approximately 60 to 70% of the population would have to get infected for the transmission to become sporadic and then eventually stop. And by 60 to 70%, we mean about 80 to 90 crores of Indians. So because many individuals, possibly in a ratio of 10:1, will always be asymptomatic, the current opportunity is ripe for integrating longitudinal serological survey data from various locations, clinical caseloads, deaths, and the case fatality ratio using machine learning and other deep learning methods to estimate the buildup of herd immunity in India. And this, of course, will help us to reasonably accurately predict the so-called endgame of this current pandemic. Our group has just published the most comprehensive analysis of the case fatality ratio of COVID-19 worldwide, and I will just share only a couple of slides on that. The second point that I want to make is about the small peaks and troughs. And we all know that while the overall course of this pandemic in India is likely to be a rise followed by a decline over a period of about 24 to 36 months, this trend line is likely to be interspersed with smaller peaks and troughs in various states and cities, which is already being seen in many parts of Europe. I think it would be most appropriate to anticipate as well as predict the smaller localized peaks using machine learning and deep learning methods, using input data such as seasonal variation, social interactions such as our festivals, preceding secular trend of cases and deaths, and other indices. And this will be most helpful to local authorities such as the BMC, about which Ashwini ji so eloquently spoke only a couple of minutes ago. The third point that I want to make is about the underreporting of cases and deaths. I think all of us understand that there is at least some degree of underreporting of COVID-related cases and deaths because of a number of reasons. I think it would be most appropriate to try to estimate the degree of underreporting using serological data, hospital admission trends, all-cause mortality, and other inputs. And this will not only be useful for COVID-19, but lessons learned here will help us uncover missed cases in other diseases and the hidden disease burden about which, you know, we never become cognizant. And my fourth and last point is about rapid diagnosis in resource-constrained setting. And I think Ashwini ji very nicely illustrated the use of chest x-rays. And I just wanted to add that we have had a long history of tuberculosis being endemic, and we have used mass chest radiography. And I think India was poised to utilize the opportunity for AI-based diagnostics as a substitute for PCR testing, which is not widely available. And hopefully we'll do that pretty soon. So I, with your permission, just only a couple of slides I wish to show you. I think you can possibly see the screen here. So our group has just published the most comprehensive analysis of the worldwide case fatality ratio of COVID-19 over time. And you can see that on your left top is the world color-coded according to the case fatality ratio of COVID-19. And on your bottom right is the distribution of countries according to which are clustered by an algorithm called K-means clustering according to the deaths per 100,000 population. So you see there is wide variability in the case fatality ratio, and it tracks with the disease burden. And we have individually tracked day by day the case fatality ratio in all countries of the world. And this is just one of the clusters in which India also belongs. And you can see this line here, the case fatality ratio slowly rose and is now dipping in most parts of the world. This is the other cluster that contains many parts of Europe as well as North America. And this dark blue line is again the case fatality ratio that rose and is now gradually declining. We also correlated 10 country level parameters and tried to see whether those are correlated somehow with the case fatality ratio. And you can see that the GDP per capita and hospital beds per population are negatively associated with fatality, which is understandable because, you know, countries with more resources may be able to do a better job. But what is interesting is that population density is also negatively associated with case fatality ratio. So countries with more dense populations have a lower fatality from COVID-19 compared to those with more sparse densities. So the point is that there are many interesting insights to be gleaned. And I think, you know, we would be well advised to take all of these things into account. And I hope that we will be better prepared for the next pandemic, but not only the pandemic, but also some epidemics, outbreaks, our own local problems as we go along. So thank you very much for listening to me, and I look forward to some discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. That was a very pertinent point about using technology tools like AI and ML to assess the extent of herd immunity in a community, and also use of data to assess the real extent of cases and deaths in this pandemic. So in the interest of time, moving on, I would restructure the discussion part of this session. So I had prepared a few questions for the panelists, and some questions have come from the audience. So to save time, I would combine both, and then I would give about 1 minute to each panelist to react to those couple of questions that I would now pose. I think the key aspect that have emerged and which would guide us in the time to come, they would relate to the primary challenges that have prevented us from effectively leveraging AI to respond to the COVID-19 pandemic. So this is one point that probably we can have some discussion from the panelists. And how could these challenges be addressed in the future to really deal with the future pandemics? The second question that the panelists could address would be about the insights that we have gained during the current COVID-19 pandemic vis-a-vis AI that we can leverage to better prepare ourselves for a future public health crisis. So these two points, I will take two questions from the audience from the chat window that we have received. Good question is about, is it possible to implement machine learning globally for the research in dealing with this pandemic? So the question about using technology on a global scale to really address the challenges of pandemics. Then another question is about can AI be used to accelerate COVID-19 treatment using CRISPR-Cas technology? This is another specific question from one of the audience members. So I think these four pointers I have put forward before the panel. Then we can have probably a reaction from each one of you in just about a minute, because we are running short of time, and I'm constrained to put this time limit for the discussion to be able to conclude within the time given to us. So let me just, quickly go to each panelist and request for the short and brief reaction. So let me start in the same order. First, Ms. Gargi Dasgupta.
Yes. So I'll be short and crisp. I think we heard across panelists, the one overarching need is the need for integration of data platforms. And I think I said this earlier in my speech, but the ability to create an infrastructure that collects, organizes, analyzes, and then builds, the building blocks for infusing or creating AI models is very, very essential. Without that, we will not be able to do all the nice correlations which we saw linking density to fatality, the unsupervised clustering, right? And I really think that is something that we as a community should give serious thought to, right? Preparing ourselves for the next pandemic, we should have our information and data architecture very well laid out. And one of the ways to do that without a lot of operating expenses is to use cloud, secure private clouds. So that's my first response. Do you want to go around?
I would like to. We have to end at 12:30, so I think we need to keep track of the time as well. So next, I would like to request Mr. Vikram Dendi to give his reaction in just about a minute, please.
Yeah. So we are on the challenges topic, right? Talk about the challenges. Yeah. I think this resonates very strongly with what everybody has said. Interoperability, I think, is going to be the key. And interoperability based on standards, I think, will be critical. Being able to really build on top of capabilities and standards like FHIR, which is a new emerging standard for data interoperability within healthcare, would be a very critical element of doing this, and also unlocks the opportunity for startups and innovators to also engage with this data.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Dendi. Next, I would like to ask Dr. Jitendra Sharma for his reaction.
Yeah, I think our moderator, Dr. Rajendra Kumar, used four very precious words, National Digital Health Mission. Now, National Digital Health Mission has to work like a tree, allowing hundreds and thousands of efforts that our colleagues have told us today to branch out of the mission. And therefore, the more examples we have, the better will be the disruption. So while we should be connected, as our good friend Vikram just mentioned, while we should be connected with interoperability and interoperability with the National Digital Health Mission tree, hundreds and thousands of disruptive branches has to get linked and come out of this tree based on a common set of data and metadata standards, which follow a graded maturity across health systems. That's all.
Yeah, thank you. So next, I would like to invite Mr. Arvinda Sevaramakrishnan for his quick reaction.
I think ruthless execution and adoption is what we need. For the pandemic, we were clearly not prepared because so far technology was considered innovation or a bells and whistles or something that is nice to have that we can talk of. We didn't realize that it was a fundamental building block. So whatever we can do to make it part of our DNA and ruthless execution, and at the same time, follow as many standards as possible, but not make following standards as a barrier to not adopting. So adopt, do the best, try to be as standardized as possible, but adopt.
Yeah, thank you so much. So next, I would like to invite Dr. Harpreet Singh for his quick reaction.
Sir, in my opinion, availability of organized, good quality data is one of the major challenges. Integration comes at a second part, but availability is the first part. We do have national data sharing and access policy available, but that policy is a bigger umbrella. We need to develop some implementation plan, particularly for health data and health research data, using the National Data Sharing and Access Policy guidelines, principles. And second, we should be doing what has to be done is establishing a health data research ecosystem, because there is one system parallelly existing which talks about predicting or telling about the epidemic has happened. But there has to be another system which should tell what is going on in the research arena. What are the groups that are working on diseases similar to this? What are level at which we are working on vaccine development or diagnostic development? So these are the two areas I think we should be focusing on.
Yeah, thank you, Arpit Singhji. Then next we have Mr. Girish Krishnamurthy.
Yeah, so Dr. Rajendra Kumar, there are two questions. I will not address the whole thing. One is the preparedness and another is about CRISPR. There was a specific question from the audience. So in the preparedness, I just want to share in a 30 seconds experience. This part of the Arogya Setu team and putting together various organizations to come together. The single most problem what we fought is there was no policy or a method to bring in Home Ministry, Telecom Department, ICMR, NDMA, MIT. So it took about 60 to 70 days to make everything work, to get the data together, to get ready for the pandemic which went out. So now it is necessity, as part of the National Health Mission, Digital Health Mission, we bring in a single most organization with policy, which can have these rules of the game written already, so that for the next pandemic, we are fully ready. So we have all the details, Dr. Rajendra Kumar, which you are part of it. We can take that as our policy making important action. Second, the question on the CRISPR. Today, the CRISPR we are applying in sensing the gene and diagnosing. Using CRISPR to treat, the technology is available, but the clinical trial, experimenting it and making it globally, it is a more than a health science challenge. It is more of a geopolitical situation. And so we got to be very careful in getting the treatment discussion about this. But my view is if we put our head together, the treatment is possible using CRISPR, but making it happen, it is a country to country decision.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Krishnamurthy. Next, we would like to invite Ashwini Bhide for her quick reaction to these key questions.
Sir, I'll just give the administrator's perspective. This time we did adopt technology, we used data-driven insights to fight the pandemic, but in a parallel world. If you see the original, the core departments and the basic approach of the government departments is still rigid. They need to be agile, they need to be more adaptive of the technologies. Then only we will be really prepared for the next pandemic. So we have to set the standard protocol, change our policies, look at the proper data collection, data sharing, allowing other external agencies also to be part of this system, and then have a very comprehensive kind of strategy to deal with the pandemic situation of this kind in future. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. So we will now have Dr. Sudhir Gupta for his reaction to these points.
So I strongly endorse the branches from the tree philosophy that was advocated by Dr. Sharma. I fully endorse it. And I would also urge some consensus on the creation of common minimum data sets that are practical and feasible to collect accurately over a longitudinal period of time. Thank you.
So thank you so much, all the panelists, for such a brilliant session covering almost all the aspects of leveraging AI and technologies for dealing with pandemics, not only the current one, but also any future health crisis. I would just like to mention a few key takeaways from this entire session, and then after that, we would conclude. So I think we saw some points being repeatedly made by the panelists and during the discussion. So first was that we need to really ensure that the use of AI and other technologies, they need to be mainstream. It should not be just a challenge or crisis driven. It should actually be part of the new normal, as we can call in the time to come. So that's the first point. Second point that came repeatedly was regarding the need for ensuring that data and data sharing can really be made more meaningful. If we follow standards and we can ensure interoperability. That's a key point in the health care system that we need to deal with. NDHM is a national level initiative to address this entire issue. And I hope in the time to come, we would see much better outcomes in our entire healthcare system. We also need to ensure that we can institutionalize all these rules of the game and the new techniques that we have at our disposal now in our entire healthcare delivery system. Use of common data systems, ensuring that data is shared across platforms, across agencies, across both private and public healthcare delivery systems. That's another key point. So let me conclude at this point of time by expressing my thanks once again to all the panelists, to our keynote speaker, and all the members in the audience who have taken the time and effort to listen to this discussion. So we have ended just on time, maybe just a couple of minutes beyond time, but I think that should be okay for a panel of this size and a topic of this gravity and magnitude. So thank you one and all once again, and I wish everyone all the very best. Thank you so much.
Thank you.